Hopefully, since you stumbled across this podcast, you understand that I might be talking about topics that are a little bit sensitive for some people and can be a little bit triggering at times for other people. So if you are one of those people that have a tendency to feel that way, please keep that in mind while listening to this podcast. Hey guys, have you thought about making your own podcast, but you're not really sure where to start? That's how I was at first, and really the only choice that stood out to me was Anchor. And let me tell you why. It was completely free to start, and it has all the tools that allow me to record and edit my podcast right from my phone or computer. And they distribute the podcast for me, so it's heard on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many other platforms. There's no minimum listenership, and you can start making money from day one. And really, everything you need to make your podcast is all in one place. I love it, and I know you will too. So download the free Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started. Friends, tonight we are getting a little bit culty. At the end of it, I will ask your opinion. Is it a religion or is it a cult? Or can you see a few aspects of both sides? Can you ride the fence on this one? I'm not positive, so I will tell you my opinion later, but this information that we are going to start out with comes directly from the website, and I am going to read pretty much word for word what the website says as of today. So on December 8th, 2014, after the passing of the Apostle Samuel Joaquin Flores, our brother Naason Joaquin Garcia received the divine calling to begin the ministry of his apostleship and with it mark a new era of the dispensation of grace. So I'm going to stop quoting there. First of all, there are a few grammatical errors in this, a few spelling errors, and a few just overall errors. So don't judge that, and I probably will not be pointing them out. I'll just read more or less what they meant to say instead of what they said. And in other news, I have absolutely no idea what it means to mark a new era of the dispensation of grace. So I don't know. If one of you knows what that means, I'm pretty much clueless on what that would mean. So back to quoting this. His calling was manifested to the church on December 14th, 2014, to guide the church, which had reached 50 nations worldwide. Shortly after his calling, the Apostle of Jesus Christ began a worldwide missionary tour through the countries and cities where the church is present, to bring the news of salvation to all humanity, because one of his main teachings that he preaches is that the gospel is inclusive. It does not discriminate against any language, race, or nationality. Okay, love it, right? We're in. We're not discriminating. He's going around. He's telling people great things, and we love it. So we're probably in at this point. He also considers that education is fundamental to familial development, which is why one of his priorities is to promote the creation of educational and entrepreneurial training centers to combat the obstacles faced by more underdeveloped communities. Also in, right? We love this. We love education. We love providing education to families who need to have a leg up, right? Love it. His spiritual mission is clear: to ensure that the word of God is preached and the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ is made known to every nation in the world. Love it. Great. Let's do it. We're in. The Apostle of Jesus Christ, Naason Joaquin Garcia, was born on May 7th, 1969, in the city of Guadalajara, Jalisco, Mexico. From an early age, his life has been dedicated to the service of God. At age 14, he was made a youth group leader in the Guadalajara church. During this time, he strived to be an example of commitment and dedication in the evangelization work of bringing the message of love and salvation to souls. In this period of time, he was sent as a missionary to Spain and Portugal, where the work of evangelization was just beginning. So this guy, since 14 years old, okay? So some of us out here with teenagers can't even get our kids to take out the damn trash. And this man is out there being a youth group leader at the age of 14, okay? So it seems impressive. It seems like he truly has a heart for God, and he is doing great things with that heart. He gets married on June 14th, 1992 to Sister Alma Zamora de Joaquin, and they have three children. So love it. We love this guy. If we just look at the website, he seems, wow, this is this guy. He's got something, right? So here are a few things that the church is based on, a little bit of the history and the teachings of his church. So I purposely didn't tell you the name of the church yet, because I wanted you to kind of get an idea of what it's like before I throw the name at you. And I have not heard this name, so it may not mean a thing to you, but the name of the church is called La Luz del Mundo, so Light of the World. Okay, so originally the leader of this church was Eusebio Joaquin Gonzalez. That was actually Naason's grandfather that started the church, okay? And it was very early on that he started this church. Like within like 1896, I believe, was when he originally had started the church. And so he goes on to be the leader of the church, and he dies in 1937. His son precedes him, or takes over after his death. Samuel Joaquin Flores, which we know as Naason's father. So Samuel was in charge from 1937 to 2014. And then Naason Joaquin Garcia takes over, and he is actually going to be the leader from 2014, and he is still their leader right now. Okay. So they describe themselves as the restoration of primitive Christianity. I have no idea what that means. I know what Christianity is, but I don't know what they mean by the restoration of primitive Christianity. They do not use any crosses or any religious image. They have a very strict dress code. From what I saw, every single service looks like people are wearing white and blue. So white, and then they have some sort of an adorning shawl or head covering or something that's going to be blue. Which kind of looks cool if you're looking from the outside in. I mean, there's somewhat of a aesthetic, visual, pleasing part about that. I don't know. It didn't look bad, but I noticed they were all dressed alike, pretty much. Women are not allowed to wear jewelry. They're not allowed to wear makeup. They're not allowed to have short hair. They kind of pick verses out of the Bible to support those things. And that was their basis for that not being able to occur. They also will have Naason Garcia, their new leader's initials, inscribed into their hymnals and their shawls. So every woman pretty much will wear a shawl during the service, or they will have some sort of a head covering, and his initials will be inscribed somewhere on those. Only men can hold a leadership position. They do have one prayer service, I think, every day that a woman does lead. They have three prayer services per day. The first at which starts at like 5:30 in the morning. And they usually last for about an hour. So you can plan at least 3 hours of your day to be around their prayer time. I noticed online that they are actually doing a Facebook Live type prayer setting nowadays. So convenient, I suppose, if you want to go that route. They often sing songs to the apostle. So they're not singing songs. That's one thing that kind of struck me about this story. They're not singing songs to God or singing songs about God. They're singing songs to the apostle about how he is the chosen man of God. So this seems like it's a bit off already to me. Children are taught from a young age that bad things happen when you defy the apostle. So they are absolutely told, do not go against what the apostle says, or bad things will happen to you, bad things will happen to us. And so basically the kids from a very young age become pretty scared to say no or to defy anything that the church or the apostle would want from them. Ex-members of this church say that they always have lived in poverty. While they were part of the church, they would live in poverty. They went without a lot. They did not eat a lot. There were definitely stories of going without quite a bit, but they were never allowed to skip tithing. Their offering / tithing time, there were people that were talking up to $5,000 at a time, and they were actually super proud to be able to put that $5,000 in the offering plate. And while I understand that, it was, she described it as moments later being in a whirlwind of, that wasn't good enough, God wants more from me. It didn't please the apostle, it didn't please God. And so even then, her heart for giving that $5,000 was not happy. The tithe is actually not considered to be a tithe of what she wants to give out of her heart, but rather a requirement in order to have salvation. So that was definitely a red flag for me. Women, for the most part, were not allowed to have an education. They were told, there were some of them that were interviewed that were told that it was just basically a waste of time to have an education, because someday their job was just to be married anyway, and they're not going to be needing an education for that. Also, there were quite a few that their parents just didn't see the point in them going past even like grade school type level, because they were just going to be married, and it was just basically a waste of time, energy, money, when they could put that into being married and being a wife or one of the apostles or his family members or something like that. So that's a little bit about the actual church, and we're going to get into the actual allegations and things like that that they have been accused of after the break. Okay, so now we will get into the accusations, the arrest, and the more sinister stuff about La Luz del Mundo Church. So the first accusations of sexual abuse actually start in 1997, which was a long time ago, if we think about that. And they're saying that they were abused years earlier, some of them up to 20 years earlier, by Samuel. So this was going on, they say, far before Naason ever came on to the scene. So there was also a report of a man saying that he was abused by Samuel when he was a teenager. And the same man also later reports being kidnapped and stabbed by two gunmen, and he does blame Samuel for this attack. They deny any and all involvement. And during that attack, when he was stabbed, he didn't receive any life-threatening wounds per se. He received 57 shallow wounds from a dagger, and it said that although he could have bled out and died, it wasn't a likely source of death, and so nothing ever seemed to be really done about it, but it seemed like it was more due to the statute of limitations, because by this time, we're a long time ago that this has happened,